I request Sri Lohit Deka sir and Sri Rajesh Arjun Beldar to kindly felicitate Sri Joshi with a Phulam Gamusa, a bouquet and a memento which has been specially designed to commemorate the Golden Jubilee celebrations at AIR Dibrugarh. An IBS officer of the 1988 UPSC cadre, Sri Joshi has been associated with All India Radio and Doordarshan under Prasar Bharati for as long as 3 decades now, in various official capacities in different parts of the country. As we cherish the association with AIR Dibrugarh for 2 long years until November 2014, we cannot but help placing on record his ceaseless and efforts and initiatives towards installation of the present 300 kilowatt DRM digital transmitter and towards digitization of AIR Dibrugarh using Natia radio automation software. Thank you so much, sir. We heartily welcome you once again. And now, ladies and gentlemen and dear listeners, it's time for us to proceed to the much awaited event of the evening, the Golden Jubilee Lecture. In a very short while from now, we shall have Sri Deepak Joshi, Deputy Director General of Prasar Bharati, with us. Sri Deepak Joshi, who has been associated with All India Radio Dibrugarh, is a very familiar face with everyone here. But I wish to mention that he has been instrumental in digitization of the first 48 stations of All India Radio using the Natia automation software. At present, he is shouldering the responsibility of the portfolio of Deputy Director General Technical, International Relations and Land Management in Prasar Bharati, the headquarters of All India Radio and Doordarshan. Esteemed audience and listeners, let us not wait any further and please join me in welcoming to the podium the Deputy Director General Prasar Bharati, Sri Deepak Joshi, and lend our ears to him as he deliberates on the topic, broadcasting on the new vistas, challenges and opportunities. So dear friends, presenting before you the All India Radio Dibrugarh Golden Jubilee Lecture by none other than Sri Deepak Joshi. Sir, the stage is yours.
Good evening, everyone. A hearty namaskar from me to all of you. Dear respected chief guest of the function, Professor Nagen Sakya sir, Sri Basumitri sir, Mr. Rajiv Barua, head of the office, AIR Dibrugarh, head of the program, AIR Dibrugarh, head of the office and head of the program, Doordarshan Dibrugarh, and all the members in this august audience and invited dignitaries. It's a matter of immense honor and pleasure for me to deliver here the Golden Jubilee Lecture on conclusion of the Golden Jubilee Year celebrations of establishment of AIR Dibrugarh on 15th February 1969 and thus completing 50 years here on 15th February 2019. Dibrugarh has never looked back and continuously moved ahead in every sphere of its development, accomplishing the motto and mission of All India Radio, which was beautifully narrated by the anchor also, that is Bahujan Hitai, Bahujan Sukhai. Before venturing into the title topic, broadcasting on the new vistas, challenge and opportunities, I will take you in a brief journey of broadcasting through the timeline in which radio broadcasting the world over and in our country evolved. World over, the radio broadcasting of music and talk programs, dramas intended to reach a dispersed audience started commercially around 1920 to 1923. In India, in July 1927, it was started by Indian Broadcasting Company, which was basically a private entity. the two radio stations which were start then were the Bombay station and the Calcutta station. You can just imagine the importance of All India Radio Dibrugarh, that very soon as the radio broadcasting stabilized itself, on 15th February 1969, All India Radio Dibrugarh was also commissioned, and it started full-fledged broadcasting of radio programs. AIR Dibrugarh, as you all know, has had illustrious past and is in forefront of all broadcast activities that are there so far as the entire northeastern part of the country is concerned, Assam as a state is concerned, upper Assam region of the state of the Assam is concerned. And it will continue to do so due to its significant geographical positioning and being a border state of our country. The state of digitization of the setup of All India Radio Dibrugarh speaks about Prasar Bharati's seriousness and the importance that it delivers to All India Radio Dibrugarh. So far, so good. We have heard about its illustrious path. I told you that it's moving ahead on full swing. Now I start addressing few of the issues. You all must have already heard the term called confidence paradox. Confidence paradox is basically a typical situation of anxiety which comes in due to or when we observe new kids on the horizon coming on the block. So, though established conventional systems face an anxiety or feel the jitters due to the new entrants in the field. This means, while older celebrity model of broadcasting is fading and losing its charm, at times feeling ignored, but simultaneously, newer models are more visible than ever before. So, the new models are moving ahead with full swing. This happened with the electronic media via broadcasting when it was started. At that time, the confidence paradox was faced by the print media or the newspapers of that time. What happened? That in the beginning, all the broadcasting was grabbed or started by the newspapers who were basically worried about their business going out of their hand or their relevance from their readers going out of proportion, they might get defunct. However, as we all see, still newspaper and electronic media coexist. None of them has been able to replace each other, and both keep on reinventing to remain relevant. So the keywords which we can pick up on here is that both keep on reinventing themselves to remain relevant. Now, if we look forward and move ahead, on the basis of our experience of everything that has got a life cycle or which continues, we have observed that change is a never-stopping phenomenon. Whatever exists, changes. That is the law of nature. Metamorphosis is inevitable. So whatever thing happen, it keeps on changing, muting. The entity that embraces changes evolves with it and keeps growing. But the entities which decline to adapt and change get extinct with time. We have been already witness to the extinction of various products and operational processes. And while witnessing them, we have found that disruption is basically a word which few people like, but mostly unlike. But disruption is leading to new formation. And it's leading to the new formation is the new accepted norm of the recept times. All the management theories world over at present give importance to the process of positive disruption. But when the disruption starts or gets initiated, midway survival depends on adapting to the happening changes. That is, the changes that come through the disruption of the existing processes, existing systems. And then these entities reinvent self and sustain themselves before the total demolition by disruption takes place. So gradually, ultimately, the disruption demolishes the existing pattern or existing model of the system and giving rise to the new system rising in the new horizon. In a similar form, traditional broadcasting too is on the crossroads to choose next course of action, because as you might have seen, the place where we have reached, we can't go back. Many new entrants are already there with us. So all of them have to move ahead. At this juncture, going digital is no more a choice or an option. Few years back, few decades back, we had the option of whether to go for digital or not. We like to continue with our conventional systems. But now it is inevitable. Now, this has given rise to other various models of broadcasting. Please listen carefully. The salient one being fixed versus mobile at reception. That means while receiving the program, you can be static, sitting on your sofa in your dining hall or in your drawing hall, or you may be on move, getting the same reception on your mobile. So this way, the reception has been divided in between two, mobile as well as static one. Then, if we speak about the video portion or television programs, multiple individual screens versus single screen two at the reception end. So at the receiving end, we can watch it on one screen or we can watch it on multiple screens. So far as delivery is concerned, RF-based versus data format-based. Regarding the timing and seeking the program, linear versus non-linear. And similarly, it affects the formatting of the program also. But on the basis of all these divisions also, two distinct sides of everyone being created, still two things are very clear regarding the field of broadcasting. And those are, video is not going anywhere. Rather, video is going everywhere. So the people who are in the field of video, who are afraid that video will go away, rather they have to embrace that now video will go everywhere. Likewise, audio, that is the programs of our radio, is still going to rule the roost. It is always going to continue the stronger medium as the most flexible and power medium. One thing is now certain, that the delivery mediums are going to evolve. So the delivery mediums will evolve as per these choices and migrate into newer uncharted territories. Plethora of delivery medium formats will change the dynamics of viewing and listening. Push format and linear media viewing come listening is going to take a back seat, though it will continue in parallel and evolve, albeit with reduction in its share of the total broadcast time chunk. So this becomes the part of the disruption of the in the existing broadcasting models that we have been seeing. Now, out of this, we distinguish conventional broadcasting as well as the new. Conventional broadcasting radio serves the audio, and the television, like our Doordarshan or the satellite channels, they serve the video. The older sibling among the broadcasting, audio and radio, is still the most potent medium of communication. The most popular medium is still the time-tested FM radio, which rules the roost, supplemented by other strategic modes as medium wave and short wave AM radio. Now, we have got an affinity for radio in the format of medium wave. Because why? It has got longer reach. Short wave radio, it has further got more lengthier reach. But as we all are aware, quality-wise, till now, FM beats them in every aspect. But the drawback, FM has hardly been able to cover, in spite of three phases of liberalization of the FM licensing and all those things by Government of India, Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, FM has hardly been able to cover about less than 50% of our landscape and population, and is still on an expansion spree. With the buying power of Indian diaspora increasing and number of sales of four-wheelers going up, the demand for FM radio programming is pushing up and coming from all the Mofussil towns, the Sundry towns, and the villages where the four-wheelers have started plying in plenty. What happens? A congestion in spectrum is being faced at most of the places. In bigger places, you see 12 FM stations, 14 FM stations are operating and fighting for the spectrum. Hence, due to this reason, a need for spectrum efficient radio broadcasting developed, and a need to opt for digital radio program delivery is being felt. Expansion of FM transmission setup is going to continue till when? Till the analog close down date is decided by the policymakers. World over, it is gradually being totally shut down. Netherlands is the first country where even FM and all analog transmission have been closed, and only now digital radio is continuing. As on date, TRAI is basically the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, which basically gives the guidelines for broadcasting, for communication, has come up with consultation paper and suggestions to Government of India in regards to digital radio broadcasting. Digital transmitters are coming in a big way, and they will lead to development of an ecosystem to gradually phase out the FM transmitters. Incidentally, luckily, fortunately, Dibrugarh is one of those few lucky stations of our network which has got such a huge power but still digital radio transmitter, 300 kilowatt digital transmitter. Now, this is in line with the international mandate to switch over to digital radio completely. So, the policy decisions from the government will be the main game changer, that when it takes a decision that now no more analog, only digital. Similarly, TV broadcast continues to be the main source of supply of video programs. As you all remember, it started with the analog terrestrial transmission, but was gradually left behind, overtaken by the satellite delivery mode. If I am not wrong, basically the first war of US on Iraq. From there itself, the satellite delivery mechanisms picked up the popularity. Both have been running in parallel. The previous one, that is the analog terrestrial transmission, being the product of the state broadcaster Doordarshan and patronized by Indian government. Along with that, satellite TV broadcasting has grown leaps and bounds and left the analog terrestrial mode of video delivery far behind. Digitization here too have improved the delivery mechanism, raising the levels to HDTV in our country, and in fact, far better other formats like 4K TV in other developed countries. So this way, the conventional broadcasting of All India Radio as well as the TV broadcasting has moved till now in our country. How is the digitization going to affect the broadcasting? Digitization is basically going to be the game changer when fully implemented. With the terrestrial transmission going digital in both radio and video delivery, it has increased the capacities and capabilities of the systems tremendously, quality-wise, channel number-wise. Challenges ahead are to develop the ecosystem of receivers and use this capability, come capacity, to its fullest maximum. Innovation in packaging the program, along with having an interspersed stream of value-added data stream, is of paramount importance. Just to tell you in brief, what comes with this digital terrestrial transmitters or digital transmission is that along with your conventional broadcasting programs, you receive plethora of other value-added data also, like data regarding the weather, climate, data regarding the reservations, any disaster management data, or maybe the data related to the stock markets. So these informations come parallelly along with our traditional broadcasting that we do. With this, radio and video dissemination, however, now finds itself in a new avatar of digitization and packaged in data format. Audio and video are now available as data through streaming on OTT. OTT is over the top, and AOD, audio on demand platforms. All of you might be nowadays watching the TV programs through Jio or Airtel. So they are the basically examples of these kind of platforms. Now, and the program which is being sent to the listeners and the viewers is basically not the analog program, but in pure technical language, it is just data. These platforms are leading to the risk of replacing the traditional audio and video delivery mediums, that is our conventional radio or the conventional video broadcasting systems, whether terrestrial or through satellite. The aggressive strategy being pursued by the telecom operators to fuel the data demand. To just tell you in simple manner, all these telecom operators like Idea, Airtel, Jio, they are basically telecom operators. They are not the broadcasters. But since the programs have been converted into data packages, so they are capable of delivering the same program which could be delivered by the transmitters through the data onto any system which can convert that digital data. This data demand has flared up the consumption of audio and video through these non-conventional mediums. So this has become 1:1. These telecom operators, they basically want to expand their capabilities to increase the data consumption as much as possible. And the best available opportunity for them is to increase the data consumption through the huge video files and audio files, and please the listeners and viewers. You must all have observed a new phenomenon is being observed in watching and listening, which says, I want, what I want, when I want, where I want. I repeat it. I want what I want, when I want, and where I want it. So, whether it is a video program or it's a radio program, these data formats, these digital platforms, provide the listener or the viewer the opportunity of seeking the program of his choice at his location in the device of his choice. So, need of the hour is that the desired program should be made available to the listeners and viewers through every available sustainable mode. I call it sustainable because technology has grown so much forward that now it is possible to deliver whether audio or video by any platform. It's all matter of sustenance, commercial viability. We keep on announcing our this program will come at this time, and listeners are waiting for it. That's our conventional broadcast system. Catch radio is going to be the new mechanism of fancy for radio enthusiasts. And similarly, for video consumers, catch video. What do we mean by catch radio and catch video? I am speaking, it's going on air, but in case if I have got a friend or a listener who wants to listen the same program at any other location, at any other time of the day, he should have that flexibility and strength to retrieving that program as per his choice. So here it comes in the category of catch radio and catch video. What will happen with this? This will really facilitate the concept that I just narrated. I want what I want, when I want, where I want it. Availability can be ensured by the radio broadcasters through live streaming and then podcast. So, in the form of linear format, the program goes on transmitters as well as live streaming. And in the form of deferred, when a person wants to listen it later on, in the form of podcast. Video programs can be made available through live streaming. They are being made, and the OTT platforms. So what's the challenge now? Challenge is to make the listeners and viewers aware of this luxury. I call this a luxury. Available to them, and where can they get the programs of their choice? So we have to provide this luxury to our viewers and listeners. If we are able to provide this, as much you must have seen, nowadays, if you go to any restaurant, it's not mandatory that if it's a lunchtime, you will be offered only lunch or thali. If you demand certain thing, no, I want some fast food, the restaurant is ready to serve you the fast food. So similarly, for our viewers and for our listeners, we should be ready to give them the program of their choice as per their convenience. Apart from these developments which would go hand in hand in the digital mode and challenging the conventional broadcasters, the newest kid, the newest entrant into the scene, which is as it is being still abhorred, detested by the conventional broadcasters, is social media. Social media are still the mature broadcasters or the broadcasters who are keenly, positively disrupting their systems and adapting as per them, or rather theoretically. Social media should be treated as a friend, not as a foe. Because in case if we consider it as our competitor or our foe, we will not be able to beat it. It's in its own domain. It has got its own domain. Everybody of us nowadays is using social media and is aware of its power. Maximum news, maximum speeches, maximum programs, people are nowadays getting on WhatsApp. Lot has been discussed and written about how the newest entrant, the social media, is threatening the conventional mediums like print, radio, and video. For this help also, as I said, the time-tested management theory of evolving a win-win situation for all will only come to the rescue of existing mediums. That means we have to shake hands with the social media and evolve a theory of win-win. They too win and we too win. They help us and we help them. In this context, the social media should not be treated as a threat or a competitor. Rather, it should be treated as a partner to us. It should be utilized in improving the awareness and visibility of the program to be broadcast, telecast, delivered, whether by radio or TV. Because only social media has got the power to be present in real time and address our listeners and viewers in real time to let them know what we are serving them, when we are serving them, how we are serving them, and where we are serving them. To give you an example, in case if I want to increase my availability to my listeners, I need to make them aware that at this time when I am speaking, it is being publicized through the social media that yes, this program is going on air. Not only that, along with that information, the information about where is it available is also sent through the social media. The flexibility to click there itself. So in case if I am able to stream my program at this juncture right now, and parallelly I am able to tweet it and pass on the information through the WhatsApp of the streaming link on which my program is going, social media messages are viral. You must have heard the word viral day in and day out. Why do we call it viral? Because it spreads like lightning. So if the information is positive and publicity is to be there, social media is the main strength which has to be used. So in this manner, social media becomes our partner, help us in reaching to the maximum possible listeners and viewers. Along with that, it provides, social media provides an alternate medium to serve listeners and viewers through the platforms which are available, integrated on social media, like FB Live or Periscope on Twitter or live broadcast on Instagram. So whatever is being presented live, it can go straight away on the social media. So this way the social media helps us. So it's not our foe. It can be our friend. Need is to maximum possible utilize the social media for our purpose. Now, however, audio and video in data format can never totally and fully replace the conventional radio and TV broadcast through airwaves and satellite. Why? Because whenever any disaster strikes, only the time-tested terrestrial network of broadcasting provides the required succor to our listeners or our viewers who are basically struck by the disaster or suffering. So, audio and video streaming and its linear and non-linear dissemination will coexist with the conventional linear broadcast in analog or digital mode. In analog mode, till we totally phase it out. In digital mode, when we make a permanent switch over to the digital. They will, however, struggle for their economic survival, because technology provides every solution, everything is possible. So all the challenges and opportunities. As they exist for the radio, as the elder sibling, and the video, coexist for the video and television with much more intricacies and complexities. Another paradox that I mentioned in the beginning is single screen or multiple screen. TV is facing this paradox, single screen versus multiple screen now. But with the life expectancy increasing and world population still growing, ratio of youth and the grown-up has become a complex dynamic entity. Youth and older generations have their own different typical viewer choices or listening choices. Older generations still enjoy community viewing amid their family on a single screen, whereas the youngsters are drifting towards their own space, their own exclusive compact screens in the form of their tablets, smartphones, and desktop computers. So availability of the video, both through RF medium and in data form, is adding fuel to this difference, this growing chasm. Nevertheless, both the viewer preferences are from the same demographic mix of old and young, posing a bigger challenge for broadcasters to package their products accordingly and deliver to the designated viewers or listeners. So what can be done? What can be the part of the disruption? Certainly, in the disruption, tweaking of the content will have to be required. So content will have to be re-emphasized and reformatted. First and the foremost, as per my opinion, is that hallowed concept of stating content is the king has to be shattered. So the part of the disruption has to be that line, that content is the king. Because a new phrase has to be coined for the new generation, which should mention that content is the queen, not king. Also needed is the broadcaster's realization that the content is a special product. So the king would be the consumer and the broadcast items would be the product, which would be kind of queen. Once broadcasters come to the terms with the idea of content as product and as delicate come important, as special as a queen, all out efforts should be made to pamper the queen, that is the content, and embellish it, decorate it, beautify it, so that it is liked and desired by the listeners and viewers. Then look at the way any other consumer products are launched. So the need is that we should basically realize that this self-realization should happen, that whatever we are producing, we are giving to our listeners and viewers, is nothing but a product, and we should treat it just like any other consumer product. Once we treat it like a consumer product, it should be launched and it should have a life cycle. A robust and strong marketing cum sales team has to take up the challenge and drive the consumption of the program produced. So along with the production of the program, it would be driving the consumption of the program, that is marketing of the program, would be the parallel stream. Marketing has to be assisted by social media in real time. Once the content realization dawns in, we accept this fact that at how this content is going to be launched. Brainstorming and reformatting of the content as per the requirement of different devices to be done. So here comes the word The programming should be agnostic of the platform and agnostic of the device. We should, particularly for the video broadcasting, the production should be such that it should be available in pleasant manner, either on the TV screens, on mobile screens, or the laptop screens. That is the different devices, different places of viewing, as per the listening and different habits. Similarly, complete news bulletins will be needed to be split into just a minute long clips, which has already started happening now. In case if you people might be following the news channels through the social media, we are able to watch just 1 minute news clip of our relevance. So we are able to select whether we want to see that 1 minute particular clip or not. Generic news needs to be further split and segmented in different topics like sports oriented, health oriented, finance oriented, weather forecast oriented, or any niche criteria. Along with that, news of different duration to suit the need of viewer as per his leisure time. Sometime your viewer or listener would like to have a news of 5 minutes, and sometime they would like to have news of only just 2 minutes, and at times during the dinner time, full half an hour bulletin. So as per the choice of the listener and viewer, broadcasters will have to give them 1 minute clips, 5 minute short news, 15 minute news, and then the conventional half hour bulletins. Along with this, the viewer and listeners need to be gently nudged, ingratiated, and enticed through social media to follow up in real time, to view and listen the programs. So with the help of this social media, we can attract our viewers and listeners. For example, if I take the example of Doordarshan, popular programs like Chitrahar and Rangoli or others in that format, which are music-based, can be further split for non-linear broadcasting in single song slices and pushed through the OTT medium. So in case from the whole program, a viewer wants to see only one particular song, it is already on the platform. We tell him this is existing, he clicks and he gets that program. Similarly, popular serials may be sliced into programs of different durations. Now when this could be accomplished, then revised strategies of monetizing the programs would be available. And for the sponsors, for the advertisers also, you would be able to give them a choice whether he wants to sponsor the 1 minute clip, 5 minutes program, 15 minutes program, or half an hour program in different format. And this can be vigorously followed by, again, whom? A dedicated, specialized, professional marketing team as per the medium through which it needs to be served to the listeners and viewers. So along with this disruption and adaption, overall what we will see is that broadcasting will be redefined, or rather I say broadcasting needs to be redefined, because broadcasting has outgrown itself and converged with communication. As I mentioned, network aggregators, they have become broadcasters. They are outsourcing the content from other providers, and they have started giving out the programs of the choice of the listeners or viewers through the over-the-top networks or the CDN networks, direct to home through satellite also. Under these circumstances, the conventional broadcasters are a confused lot amid what is their forte. I mean, what should they do? Production of quality content or delivery of the outsourced content? whether to produce the program themselves or get the program from outside and just broadcast it on their platform. Now for this, as on today, no fixed elixir recipe exists. It's all by hit and trial by different broadcasters as per their whims. What is felt is, however, is a judicious mix to have its own uniqueness, offering unique programs for viewing and listening, which pleases all the sensory receptors of the humankind, will give out the solutions. So ultimately, psychologically, we need to understand the sensory receptors of the humankind. By understanding that, innovating, and by innovating only, survival is the guru mantra. Because if we consider the listener and viewers as the consumers, then consumers are the humans. And the humans are looking for entertainment and infotainment. But the entertainment and the infotainment is the next higher step on the pyramid of needs above the basic instincts and the hunger. So as the consumer rises up on the pyramid of need, choices improves, choices change, and the broadcaster needs to keep a pulse of those tastes of the listeners and viewers. To conclude, if I may say, what may be the way ahead? Way ahead, what I feel is a paradigm shift. It will be required in the way broadcasting is being conventionally done in the past decades. Path-breaking technologies will have to be introduced with the extensive uses of artificial intelligence technology and data analytics. By saying this, I am merging purely into the information technology field. Artificial intelligence mechanism would be required or would be used, or rather it is being used, I will just give you the example, to know the choices of viewers and listeners and to assist them in knowing their program and liking better and satisfying their specific program needs more efficiently. What will the data analytics do? Data analytics will help in getting the automated actual correct feedback about the services being given to the listeners and viewers and how many listeners or viewers are taking those services. This will assist the broadcasters in knowing the mood of viewers and listeners and enhance the visibility of these programs being available. Not only that, it will help in enticing new viewers and listeners. This will ultimately help the broadcasters in monetizing the broadcasting more effectively. And if they are able to sustain themselves commercially and offer good quality programs, sky is the limit for their progress. So, new innovative models of hiring the content and delivery needs to be evolved. Entertainment and information should be seen as a dynamic entity. Dynamic entity means it will always keep on moving. It needs to keep on moving. So, whosoever tries to restrict and stifle the dynamism in the broadcasting by any kind of binding on listeners or viewers is finally going to perish, and it will become a suicidal mission for those broadcasters. With this, the last point that I will address is, what about the public service broadcasters? Public service broadcasters have got their own mandate of serving the society. So in this matter, world over the challenge is being faced and the same thoughts are going on. Policymakers will have to take a call on the role of public service broadcasters. Profit cannot be only motive of public service broadcasters. But said that, however, they cannot continue to run as a loss-making entity forever. So a balanced blend of earning their own operational cost, augmented by funding by various agencies to meet the mandate of public service broadcasting would be the ideal solution. So these were the challenges, and in case if we had accept the conventional systems and modify them to accept the new technologies, there is no looking back. Broadcasting is going to strengthen. To just give you an example, maximum of you people must be watching the program on YouTube. You just watch a program once in YouTube. YouTube knows what kind of program you are liking. And from next time onwards, it starts giving you the hint. Now, that's the kind of work which is being done by the artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence of the system identifies the habits, taste, choices of the listeners and viewers, and further entices them to try something else. With these few words, I conclude my this session. Again, wishing in a conventional manner, happy birthday to All India Radio Dibrugarh. And as the day holds its importance today, a very happy Valentine Day to all the invitees here, to all the listeners who are listening to the program. Thank you so much.